If it's just a three, if Floyd, move over one senior.
Yeah, come on in, y'all. Come on, come on.
This sound. My check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Yeah. Can y'all hear me? How's sound? Can y'all hear me back there? And the sound is good.
Yeah. Yeah, we can hear.
We're good.
Okay.
That sounds perverted.
You want to sit right here? Okay, so I'm going to begin. Adrien Broner versus Adrien Granados, February 18th. I'm going to work by about the promoters and Mayweather promotions. I want to thank you all for coming to this press conference here. I know you guys have to get out there and start covering the fight here coming here soon. So we're going to go ahead and open up for questions.
Yeah.
We're going to open up for questions and ask these guys anything you want.
Steve, you want to come up, please? Yeah. No, let them go. Let's get straight to the question. I do not talk.
All right, questions?
Adrien, right here. Adrien, right here to your left. Hi, good evening. Tell us about the fight in Ohio. What that means to you?
It means a lot to me. You know, coming back to the hometown, you know, I gotta put on a great show, like I always do. And I'm not just coming to fight anybody. You know, his name might not be as known as mine, but I can tell you one thing, this guy's not gonna lay down, and I know he's gonna be tough, and he's coming to fight.
Adrien, Chris Carr here with the Fight City. You got a card on the 10th, you got a card on the 18th of fighting. Is there a worry that you're stretching yourself too thin? You're a promoter, you're now a boxer. Granados is focusing on this fight. This is his million-dollar ticket. Are you overlooking him because of all the stuff going on?
I never overlook any opponent, you know, in this game. And, you know, right now I'm just focused on my fight. You know, I got great promoters. I got a great promoter team. You know, Ravon Littlejohn, he's going to make sure everything's okay. And you know I got a big bro helping me on my show, so I know my show is gonna be okay. So I'm okay.
Question for Floyd. Floyd, Adrien said when he was talking to media earlier that he's kind of seeing the light, and he said he's a bit sort of calmed down, and he's really training harder than ever. He said part of that came from talking to you and your influence. Can you talk about that? He also said, we haven't seen the best of him, and now we are going to see that.
I think it's all about growth. You know, everybody go through certain periods in their life where certain experiences you go through in life, you grow from it, you learn from it. I think that everything should be a learning experience. Adrien Broner is, we all know that he's a hell of a fighter. You know, one of the biggest names in boxing. I mean, you may have another guy that's, say, he's undefeated. Say you have another fighter that's young and undervised and says that he's undefeated, but Adrien Broner has charisma. He has that star power. He has what it takes to become a household name, but with everything takes time. You know, I'm gonna continue to help him push his brand, you know, AD Promotions. I will always stand behind him. You know, you live and you learn. And he's still young. He has a lot left. And so we all want to see him go out there and entertain.
Hey, Adrien. You know, when you fight, you like to usually pick and choose your spots, and you're pretty economical with your punches. Will that, you know, like Adrien Granados throws a lot of punches, will that play into your style? Will that make for an exciting fight?
Whatever you bring to the table, we're going to be ready for. You know, this training camp has been incredible. And you know, we still got a couple of weeks left, so I just want everybody to watch, and it's gonna be a great show.
Adrien, there was talk of you coming potentially to ringside last year to the UK when Ricky Burns was fighting. Is there still a prospect that you could fight in the UK at some point this year?
Most definitely, but right now, my biggest test is Adrien Broner. You know, if we can't make a good fight with Ricky Burns, then we have to take that up with my team, but right now we focus on February 18th.
Adrien, to left one more time. In 2015, you fought three times. Last year, you fought once. What's the plan for 2017?
Just being more positive.
Let me touch on that. In 2017, we're gonna try to keep all these young fighters active. Adrien Broner deserves to fight this year three or four times. He's young, he's hungry, and it's all about keeping him mentally in the right place. You know, sometimes it's not Adrien that sometimes that goes into another place. It's the people that sometimes surround us. But when you have a positive guy right here to Adrien Broner's right, a guy that's had his back for a long time, you know, if I continue to communicate with Adrien and a positive people that's in his life continue to communicate with him, the only thing we can do is get great results. And, you know, of course, this fight will be on the best boxing network in the world, Showtime. Of course, we're the A side. We will always remain the A side. And tonight, I know it's right now, it could be live on some media outlets. Please tune in tonight as we have a unification bout. And Mayweather Promotions and other boxing promotion companies, AB Promotions. We're going to continue to give the people what they want to see, and it's all about excitement.
Question for Steven. What kind of fight do you think this is going to be in the ring, and how do you think this fits into the rest of your schedule that you've announced?
You know, we announced a really solid first quarter, a lot of, you know, big marquee fights. I think Adrien's fight here is the sleeper of them all. Because it's such a great style matchup. You know, you can go back, to a lot of the fights in history, and you have, you know, Adrien's style, and you've got a really aggressive, hard-charging style against a slick boxer, puncher. You know, it's a classic matchup. So, again, people may not know the name Adrien Granados, but if you do your homework and you see he's got four losses, but those four losses are all split decisions, to guys who are combined 72-1, you know, that guy's had a hard road, and he's hungry. And I know he's going to bring out the best in Adrien and vice versa.
Back here, Floyd.
Hey. I know you're promoting Adrien's, involved in promoting this particular fight, but obviously you guys have a bit of a friendship, mentor, sort of pupil sort of relationship. Can you talk about just how often you and Adrien talk about things? Forget about the promotion of the fight, but just where you get on the phone or you see the person, you try to counsel him about the things that you can teach him that you've been through.
On a regular, but you know, most of the time, Adrien will call me in the morning, or I will call him just to check on him, see how he's doing, how his family is, his children, see what's going on in his life. And I'm always trying to keep him in the right place. You know, even like myself, you know, once upon a time in my career, what I had, even though you can be with a certain company, but it's the people that's around you that can get you, you know, off track. Me, myself, when I was young, I had a bunch of negative people around me, so I was a negative person. But once I surround myself with better people and people I knew genuinely cared and wanted the best for me, I became a better person. Not just physical, but mentally, and also I was put in a better position, a better financial position. You know, when I got with Al Heyman, and then I had a lot of young guys around me that only thing they wanted to do was club and drink and party. Me, myself, I seen the bigger picture. They just wanted to party and live a life right then and there. But I knew I had children to feed, a family to take care of, so had to move all that aside and focus on what I had to do. And that's the same advice I try to tell him. You know, sometimes Adrien will call me and we have some real, real deep conversations that the world would never even know about. Real deep. And I just tell him, listen, don't worry about that. Your children need you, your family needs you, and I need you to go out here and become the next pay-per-view superstar.
Adrien, can you address what Mayweather said, that you can look to him and maybe learn from the lessons that Floyd has had? What has it meant to you, and what does it mean for you going forward in terms of the way you handle your business, more specifically outside the boxing ring?
Like you said, you know, our relationship, you know, when we talk, it's very personal, and he tried to keep me level-headed, because sometimes I can get high-headed.
sometimes he can, you know, he called me, and he have his days. Every day is not the same. Sometimes he have his days, and I say, Adrien, come on, you gotta rock with me, because, yeah, I mean, that, you know, in our own language, that's our language, of course, you know, my background, of course, I come from the inner city. I'm a comedian. I'm not adjust and adapt to any situation. But I tell you got to stay with me. I need you. You're one of the biggest names in boxing. And even though I'm not out there competing or fighting anymore, I still live through these fighters. You know, when these fighters go out there and win, I feel like I'm fighting. So I know how it feels to be on this side, and I know how I feel to be a fighter. But every day, I say to myself, I got in the sport of boxing as a promoter when I got older. I got in the sport of boxing as a promoter to help fighters, to help them. Because for so many years, fighters have been taken advantage of. And in the beginning, I didn't understand the business, even though when I was 19, you know, 19 years old, a teenager, I touched down in Las Vegas, and it was a six-figure contract. It was a six-figure paycheck, check right there on the desk. I went into Top Rank office. I didn't see nothing. I didn't care what it said. You know, I said, okay, where to sign it? Because, you know, I got to realize I'm a kid from the inner city. And I did have, you know, I had an up and down life. Whereas when I stayed in Jersey with my mother, I lived seven deep in a one bedroom in a project building. And then when I stayed with my, in Michigan, with my grandmother, because she raised me, I never really had a stable home. You know, sometimes I stay at my dad, sometimes I stay at my mother. But through all that, through everything that I've been through, it made me who I am today. And that's the same thing. All my trials and tribulations and things that I've been through, I try to help Adrien and give him the same advice. I want him to be better than me. I want him to surpass me. I want my records to be broke, because I would like to be here to see my records be broken. I'm like, damn, it finally happened. You know, I don't care if it's 4 years from now, 10 years from now. I want to see it happen. I mean, that's because I feel like I never knew. I knew I was going to get to a certain level. I just didn't know how high. But I kept believing, you know, every time. And this is the truth. When I used to see fighters fighting, it's no different from when I seen Adrien Broner fight McDonald. And I said this to myself. I said, this motherfucker got hurt. This motherfucker is tough. And it made me respect Adrien Broner a lot more once I faced McDonald. For him to come from a small weight, because you gotta realize, even though I jumped from a small weight, I gradually moved up. Because that's the way he's supposed to do. He made a big jump. And I'm gonna be honest, McDonald's one of the hardest hitting motherfuckers I ever fought. And Adrien Broner can vouch for that. He hit hard. But, you know, for Adrien Broner to get knocked down by McDonald and hop up and continue to fight and say, motherfucker, I'm still here, I ain't going nowhere. I mean, if you're not a fighter, you would never understand that. But if you're a fighter and you've been in the crunch, there's a motherfucker in there. And I just want to tell Adrien, I'm proud of him. You know, I'm proud of him through all the stuff that he's been through. He's still able to go out there and perform, but the main thing is he's a good father. He's always with his children. And just like myself, you know, I'm always going to be a great father. Before I'm be known as a great boxing champion, I'm going to be known as a great father, because that's the thing that's important to me, because our children are the future. So we want to make sure that our children surpass us and be better than us. And I just tell Adrien on the regular, it's all about business. It's not what you can do inside the ring. What can you do once you get all that? We have to turn that into something. And so, and those are the conversations we have. And yeah, a lot of times they see us joking and laughing and smiling, but to get, you know, a G4 jet, to get a G3 jet, to get Rolls Royces, and to get diamond watches, that's after, that's later on. All I ever wanted, and the same thing like Adrien, and I think it's really my fault. I say for all these young fighters that's coming up, it's really my fault, because when they young, they see Floyd Mayweather, they watch, at one particular time it was 24/7, they watch All Access, and they see me flashy, flamboyant. And like, so if I was a kid and I seen, I'd be like, I gotta get that same thing. But I don't wanna, I really wanna tell these young fighters, my whole focus, all I really wanted to be was the best. I didn't care. When I was went to top rank sometimes and they said, well, we can't afford to pay you for this fight, this next fight on this date. I said, how much can you pay me? If they gave me a number, I'm gonna just throw a hypothetically throw a number out there. They said, I only can pay you $7,500 or $10,000, I'm like, give it to me. Because I seen a bigger picture. I wasn't thinking about just right now. I knew I was gonna have a long career because my dad told me this is the first thing my dad installed in me when I was younger. He said, the less you get hit, the longer you last. So now I look back at my career, still sharp, right, as of right now, I'm still sharp. I'm still on point. I didn't let the sport retire me. I retired from the sport. I mean, shit, if I was Steven, would I want Floyd Mayweather to come back? Absolutely. I'd give him the whole Brinks truck.
I'm off.
But, you know, this is about Adrien. I stand behind Adrien. I want to continue to support him. Sometimes he'd be upset. Big bro, no. Just relax. You know, I'm here with you. Just relax. You know, he's only human. I mean, and it's just like this, you know, they're going to take shots at him, but I tell them all the time. Certain people in the media, or certain people on social media, or people that don't even know you. Everybody's an internet thug. Everybody's an internet gangster. Everybody can type up something negative about you, something bad about you. Everybody can make up fake stories. At the end of the day, I tell them that this, like, everybody here right now can judge me and say, oh, yeah, we know what I'm saying. I mean, at the end of the day, that little lady right there, that's what I care about. And that's the same thing that he should care about. Your children, because that's who's gonna love you through thick and thin, through it all. If you make a lot of money, if you lose it all, your children are gonna love you unconditional. The media is gonna move on to the next. The fans are gonna move on to the next. They're gonna keep inventing more and more fighters. At one time it was Janeiro Hernandez. This kid is crazy for fighting him. Then they come and say, Angel Man Freddy, the next best guy that quit, wipe him out the box. Then they say, oh, this guy. Then they say, oh, that guy. Then they keep building it. Then they say Diego Corrales undefeated. Then they say Ricky Hatton. Then they say De La Hoya. Then they say Canelo. Then they say Pacquiao. And all I say is this. I tell AB this. Always have patience. You want to get to where you're trying to get to. A true champion can take a loss and bounce back. And I don't have to take a loss in the ring because I took losses on the outside of the ring. When I lose a loved one, that hurts deep. No different from when my best friend killed himself on FaceTime when he committed suicide and murdered his wife. You don't think that hurt? But still, mentally, I have to be in the right place because I know that I have a whole company that's backing me and believing in me. I didn't want to let Steven down. When I went to Steven and I said, this is the deal I want. First I went to HBO and said, this is the deal I want right here. And once they couldn't get the deal done, it's not like I wasn't loyal because nobody knew this. I fought under HBO for years. Just fight to fight. And it was telling the world, making the world think that I was under a contract, and I wasn't. Fight to fight. Then I finally said, when I came home from doing my little small bid, I said, listen, this is the deal that I need they said, nobody's going to give him that deal. I went to Steve, he said, no problem. So I will always be loyal to, you know, I'm always be loyal to people that treated me good. And they didn't treat me good, they treated me great. Within my deal, everything that I wanted within my deal, I got. And everything that I asked for within my career, I got, but I had to go out there and produce first. You have to go out there and produce first. And I say, okay, I say, yeah, listen, I need this big boy mansion built. It costs $15 million. I need it. I need this built. I said, no problem. I was retired when I got that built. Okay, that's one thing. When I wanted the Bugatti, I got it. When I wanted three jets, I got it. But I had to go out there and produce. This is not nothing that happened overnight. Same thing with Adrien Broner. He gonna get to where he got, where he wanna get to. I'd have been in the gym. I don't have to see a fighter fight. I can see him in a boxing gym, and I can just see certain movements. I said, oh yeah, I can see why he's world champion. Because when I say this, I really mean this. Like, McDonald can punch. And I'd have been in there with some of the best. And every guy that's at the top can punch. They all can punch. No different from when you look at, you know, we look at Canelo, and then we look at Amir Khan. And they say, oh, Mayweather did this to Canelo, so Amir Khan is gonna be able to do the same thing. It's two totally different fighters, it's two totally different worlds. There's a difference between, I tell y'all this all the time, there's a difference between being talented and God-gifted. There's two different. You got a lot of talented fighters. But when you mix them all together, I'm talented and God-gifted. So I got two things on my side. Most fighters only got one thing. And we will see Adrien Broner. We will see the best of Adrien Broner. And this guy that he's fighting is not a pushover. And I'm going to continue to help him grow and push his company. You know, it's a great feeling to wake up and say, damn, I took this guy who was just this fighter who was walking to the boxing gym and taking a bus to the boxing gym to making seven-figure paydays. But I had to work. It wasn't easy. Badu Jack never complained, though. He never complained. He never complained. He never cried. All he said is every time we got him a fight, he never complained about the money. Most of these fighters nowadays, all they do is bitch and complain about the money. We want the money. We want what Mayweather got. Well, you have to take the same road Mayweather took. I fought 17 times in a year and a half before I fought for the, that's the reason why I fought for the world title, and I fought the best guy at the weight. And then once you get to a certain point, a certain pinnacle where you accomplish everything that you want to accomplish, then you got to say, what next? Then you want to see people, everybody around you, win and accomplish certain things. Because there's nothing else I can really do in the sport no more. You late, Leonard? Okay, we'll come back. Okay, well, we'll pass the mic back over there. Go ahead, Andy.
So just so you guys know, we're about the middle of the Thomas Delorme fight, about round five. So if we want to do one or two more questions.
Yeah, we take some more questions. Go ahead. Well, I'm sorry.
No, Adrien, you got one. So I know you had a challenging year last year. How did that change your perspective and change you?
Last year, you know, was one of the roughest years of my profession. And, you know, I've been through some humbling moments. And, you know, it's good I got mentors like Floyd Mayweather. You know, it's good I got positive people like LeVon Little John inside of me. And, you know, they helped me get through these situations. And now we're on better and positive things.
What changes every day in particular? Have you maybe changed any of the people around you? Or?
What is that?
I said, what changes have you made? Have you changed any of the people around you? Because Floyd before was talking about having positive people around.
You know, most definitely. You know, you definitely got to, you know, he tells me this all the time. You know, once you decide to do right, you're going to lose a lot of your friends or, well, a lot of people that you thought was your friend. You know, because a lot of people are around for the wrong reasons. And now that I'm doing right and now that I'm not clubbing so much or doing the crazy wild stuff that I used to do. You know, there's a lot of people that really don't want to come around or don't be around no more. So, you know, We're just doing all positive things, man. That's the new thing for me.
And also, I you were saying before that you can't fight Maidana right now because he's retired. But would you like to avenge the lost supporter at some point?
Of course. But like I said before, you know, my main objective is February 18th and putting on a great show for you guys and all my fans.
Floyd, what are some similarities you see between yourself and Adrien, both inside and outside the ring?
Well, what I want Adrien to do is go back to the combination punch of Adrien and Broner. Because if you go back to, you know, when you go back and look at me in the beginning, before I became Money Mayweather, when I was Pretty Boy Floyd, man, I was a motherfucker then. you know, once I reached my last hurrah, really was with Arturo Gatti. After I reached that point, my body was all broken down, you know, just from so, not just from taking punishment, but for just so many different hard training camps, pushing myself day in and day out, wearing and tearing my body, hands broke down, body broke down. Still able to work, that's why I had to start working even harder, just so I can compete, I mean, at the highest level, but because my body had broke down. My last hurrah was with Arturo Gatti, and I still, since I had a sharp mind and I didn't take any punishment, I still was able to beat all the top fighters, you know, with chess moves, just being smart, and just with my experience. Far as on the outside, what I see from Adrien, you know, just he has what it takes, because if you look at his social media following, he has a hell of a following, and a lot of fighters don't have as many followers as Adrien Broner has. You got guys that's been to the Olympics and won medals and still don't have that charisma and what it takes to be the next thing. Adrien, he can box, he can punch, he got fast hands, but I need to go back to that combination puncher that when I first went to Cincinnati, I was like, no kid can fight. I said, he talking some shit like you meet, but he can fight. And then he would, you know, the first time I see him fight, another time I see him fight, I like was he swept his kid with a left hook, Jason. I don't know his last. Okay. Oh, he swept him with a hook in Mexico in the first round, if I'm not mistaken. Then I see him fight in Cincinnati. So I was like, yeah, this kid gonna make some noise. You know, I was impressed, still impressed, and still want to see him do better. Anytime I can give him pointers, when we're in the gym, I'm giving pointers. It's just small things that, you know, that can make him separate the good from the greatness. And some big fights out there for him, and I'm gonna be there to support him.
Adrien, final question for me here. February 18th, you're gonna be fighting for Adrien Granados. For better or for worse, you've been the bad guy. You enjoy it, you talk trash, you've made a name, you've been a bigger than life in boxing. How do you convince, though, you know, the big players, you know, Cleveland Cavaliers, Apple, Nike, all those guys who want to do business, that you're not this bad guy, but you are grown up, and you deserve to be in board meetings, and you make decisions, and you're ready to be, not just the world champion, but a guy who's ready to carry a brand?
Why is it always that the guys that go out there and just speak from the heart, why are those guys the bad guys? Whereas you got athletes that's controlled, just so somebody can say, I'm gonna pay you money and we can control what you say, that's not cool. The cool thing is about with my career, and the same thing with Adrien Broner's career, people should accept you for being real and not being fake. There's a lot of NBA players out there that's fake and don't say the things that they really want to say. NBA players really want to go out there. A lot of NBA players, a lot of athletes want to go out there and say, I'm the fucking best, and nobody can fuck with me. So is there a problem with me going out there and say, yo, I'm flashy, I'm flamboyant? Shit, look at my wrist. I ain't like I'm lying. Or saying that, oh, I drive a Bugatti, or I got a big mansion. It's true, but how we got it, by we worked hard to get it. It's not like we went out there and robbed anyone for it. To whereas if not me anymore, but I'm saying the younger Mayweather, yes, I'm gonna have rims on all my cars. So since my neighbor, he works on Wall Street and he has a Mercedes with no rims, does that make him any better than me? Or does it make a fighter better than me? Because a fighter wants to say, I may win, I may not win. And I going out there and say, I know I'm gonna win. I know I'm the better man. Because that's a way to fucking back out the block when a fighter say, I'm not really sure if I'm gonna win or not. So if he loses, the media's not that hard on him. My thing is this. We as athletes and as human beings, we have one life to live, and I think everybody should speak their mind, what they really feel. That's no different from a man and a female in life. Females want you to, they just want to hear what they want to hear from you. They don't want the truth. They don't want the truth. This is true. What we do is just speak from the heart. That's all we do is speak from the heart. This man should be able to speak from the heart. Listen, if I never had a deal with Nike, even though it's Nike, but we like to say Nike. If I never had a deal with Nike, Adidas, I ain't gonna say Reebok ain't never gave me no money because I think I made some names with Reebok. But I never really had a crazy deal with none of these companies. That's not gonna define my greatness. That don't define your greatness. Because you got athletes that had deals with Under Armour. You had athletes that had deal with Nike, Reebok. I mean, you name all these different brands that these fighters had deals with. And guess what I did? I swept them all. Swept them all. So that has nothing to do with it. I don't want to be controlled. If I got to be with a company, I got to be controlled, then I don't want to be with the company. Because I know who I am as a man, and I got dignity, and I got pride, and I'm going to stand as a man every day. So I don't think that no athlete out there should be controlled and told what to say. No different from, you got athletes, you got people that have a foundation. If I'm an NBA player and I have a foundation, you know what it's going to say when I go out there and do for the people? The NBA cares. It's not going to say the Floyd Mayweather Foundation cares. It's going to say the NBA cares. Or the NFL. You see all these different, these athletes in today's time are controlled. I don't want to be controlled. I want to be able to live my life the way I want to live it, and I'm happy with how my career has went. If Adrien Broner go out there and continue to fight, make smart investments, he don't need Nike. Just my ultimate goal is take, I'm going to make TMT just like it's a Nike. It may take time. It may take 20 years. It may take 30 years. But the thing is this, I own my brand outright. And if we look at this, just look at these athletes. I respect every great athlete. But when we go look at Ali, he sold his name. We go look at the Jordan brand symbol. Nike owns that. Now, me, myself, my honest opinion is Michael Jordan should own not just a piece of Jordan, he should own a piece of Nike because he made Nike a multi-billion dollar company. But these are the things that we don't talk about, that we shy away from. If you're the best, you say you're the best. When I was in the game, I was the best. And when the history books is written, you look at all the records, and I broke all the records. And then until somebody break my records or show me different, y'all got to label me TBE. Because when they say the greatest, remember when they say the greatest, anybody can be great in one night. When you talking about TBE, that's the best ever. That ain't just in one night, that's forever. Go ahead, take the mic.
Like, before the jump in, Adrien, because I spoke with your confidant here, Mr. Littlejohn, I know you want to be there when Cleveland Cavaliers had a parade, you be the fire marshal, your guys. As I said, how do you convince them that, hey, this man with Sana, this, you know, me, Adrien Broner, but you see here, I am a smart guy, I am a businessman, I am a guy who you can trust to carry your brand to be a partner with?
I just know, I trust Ravon Littlejohn. I trust Floyd Mayweather. And you know, I know they're not gonna leave me in the wrong way. So you know, whatever they tell me is gold.
Well, just to follow up on what you were talking about, Sheila. We've seen a lot of athletes unable to really make the transition to executive, especially in the NBA. And you're really passionate about Mayweather Promotions. It's obvious the whole week you've been working and doing all the labor-intensive work. What are some of the adjustments you have to make going from an athlete to an executive to perform at on a high level as an executive?
It's crazy. Thinking about the fighters right now when you ask me that. You have to, these fighters, what they do is this. Fighters come, and I did it in the beginning of my career a couple times, even though I had it. You go to your promoter and you get an advance. What these fighters do is they come and get an advance on their fight purse. They get another advance on their fight purse. So they get advance after advance after advance after advance. Then when you tell them, like, no, like you can't. If I give you one more advance, then you're not gonna have no money. You're not gonna have any money when you fight. You know what they say? That's when we become the bad guys. We become the bad guy. You take a guy that was only making $4,000 or $5,000 and take him to making, you know, $150,000, $200,000 or $300,000. Then they go out there and go buy a Bentley for $200,000 and only got $150,000. But once again, we're the bad guy. You don't have Floyd Mayweather money. You can't live Floyd Mayweather lifestyle. I'm not here to take from fighters. We are here to help fighters. I got Mayweather Promotions to help fighters. And you gotta realize this. We're gonna have good days and we're gonna have bad days. But I tell fighters this. You're gonna win some fights, you may lose some. But at the end of the day, what we try to do at Mayweather Promotions is put you in the best position possible. That's all we try to do. You know, we have so many people that's in boxing, that's involved in boxing. You have so many people that know so much about boxing, but never can't even throw a fucking jab. But everybody know about boxing. Everybody know about the business, but nobody has gotten taken advantage of. Once you get taken advantage of, or you fight and they tell you your purse is a certain amount, like in my career, they told me my purse was a certain amount, and then they tell me, oh, you can't get the fight if we can't squish the purse. You know, when they take millions off the purse, you're like, what is this? But once again, I ain't quite complaining. I said, let's make it happen. Part of the fight game.
Let me address that briefly because, you know, I've seen that transition, you know, from this seat, you know, dealing with Floyd and Leonard in one role and then later in a different role. When you want to be great, you want to be great at everything. So I think what has defined Floyd and what I've seen him as a promoter is if it's a $100,000 showbox, he wants to do the biggest $100,000 showbox there is. You know, if it's a $1 million event at the Barclays Center, he wants it sold out and he wants everybody in town talking about it. So it's actually not that different. You adjust where your energy is going. And now he wants to be the best marketer and promoter and the best at selling tickets and the best at making commercials. You know, but it's the same drive for excellence. Floyd goes, and I've seen this in Adrien as well. There are guys when we're doing marketing lines, for example, you know, say, okay, you know, watch it on Showtime this Saturday, 9:30 p.m. And you say, okay, that's good. You know, what Floyd will do, and I've seen Adrien do it too, they'll say, no, let me do it again, I can do it better. This is after I've already said, okay, we got it, let's move on. It's like, no, that's not the best I can do it. So it'll take two or three. Everyone else is ready to move on because check the box, got it, done. But these guys know, no, I can do it better. Let me switch it up a little bit. You know, and so it's, in a way, it's being competitive even at non-competitive things. Like, I want to deliver my lines better than any other fighter in the sport. It's being competitive at these little tiny things that people take for granted.
How soon can we expect another Mayweather Promotions card
here? Very soon. Very soon. We have two events in the next 4 weeks. Two boxing shows in the next 4 weeks. We're very busy.
I thought I was going to travel.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, so we're doing what we need to do. We have 30 fighters at this present time, and Like I said, we're one of the elite promoters.
We got 30 fighters just on Mayweather Promotions, but we work with way more fighters than 30 fighters. Our number is crazy. But, you know, we don't throw that out there. But we just said we got 30 fighters, but we really have others. They ain't even the real number. But, you know, that's not for the world to know. As long as we know that we're giving back. That's what I mean, that people don't understand everything that goes on behind the scenes. Behind the scenes. I mean, because Adrien Broner don't have to have a contract with Mayweather Promotions. But at the end of the day, with me helping him with what he's doing, I'm going to give it 100% just like he's with Mayweather Promotions. So he's a part of our movement also. He's a part of our family also. I think we're good, ladies and gentlemen. We have to get out there because I can't wait to tonight. They're going to come out tonight.